to talk tamales with two women that honestly need no introduction. We'll be having our event today with Dr. Carmen Tafolla, an internationally acclaimed Chicana writer from San Antonio. She served as the Poet Laureate of San Antonio between 2012 and 2014, and was named the Poet Laureate of Texas between 2015 and 2016. And she's joined with Dr. Ellen Riojas Clark, UTSA Professor Emerita. And the one thing I thought was very cool is that she served as the Educational Content Director for the PBS series Maya and Miguel, which I loved, and my nieces and nephews loved. So I was happy to learn that you were involved in that.
I'm abuela and then I.
And Dr. Ellen Riojas Clark is part of the L3 committee that was integral to opening the Latino Collection and Resource Center. And if you haven't seen, Carmen Tafolla is one of our champion authors who's featured on our bookends that you can see when you visit the collection. And so that's our short introduction. I'll go ahead and let you ladies get started. We're going to be talking tamales, a little bit about the history of the tamalada, and reading some excerpts from their book.
We're going to make this rather informal, okay? So, I'm way older than that man. So, I'm the Mera Mera Tamalera. That's the name that I was given because I've been making tamales, I just realized, for 56 years. That's longer than she's been alive.
No.
So it's a long time. A long, long time. And the reason why is my mother never made tamales. She came from the Fort Worth, Dallas area. And I don't know, maybe they don't make tamales in that area. But my dad's family would make them and never got the help. But anyway, once I established my own household, decided to make tamales. So every year would have a big tamalada at the house. So for those 50 years, I would get ready to have all my friends come in, writers and artists and politicians. Everybody went through my kitchen. It was a big job because I would make 150 pounds de masa. 150 pounds of masa. So you have to think about that. I have ollas or pots that are huge. And then I'm kind of short, so to beat all that masa like this was a big job. And to do all of the hojas that were required to do all of that many tamales was huge. So, I do have a PhD, so I got smart. And I figured out one thing. It's about culture. Tamales is our culture, it's our history. And Gavin's going to tell you the history in a while. But the other thing I also understood was that it was about the process of making tamales. And I said it was tamales, not about the product. So it really didn't matter what that product tasted like or looked like. It was just important to get together and make them. And if you made them, you were to think of the best tamales in the world. So Godwin and her cousin, Ernie Bernal, would come over with their children. I would tell people, just bring a pot, and then you can take it to mama's home and cook it. But here's my secret. It has nothing to do with what she's going to tell you about with the history of the mother thing. This is 1980s, you know, whatever year I started making it. No, earlier than that. Yeah, the 60s, making tamales. So, tanta hoja, if you ever did them as a child, you know you had to put them into soap, because corn shucks are very, very brittle. You have to soak them overnight in very hot water. So your hands end up being chapped and just not, it's hard on your skin. So I have a top-loading washing machine. The top-loading machine. You put the clothes in like that. So, I wash the washing machine with vinegar twice. Get rid of all of the soap residue. Le pongo el agua más caliente, because you need very hot water. Put all the hojas in there, put the top on it, and then pull out the stopper so it doesn't agitate. You don't want it to agitate. When my mother did it, she'd call me, she'd go, what do I do with all those pieces? Because it would come apart. I said, Mom, you weren't supposed to let it wash. So you let it, you pull out the stopper and it just soaks. So the next morning, what do? You put it on spin. spins out all the water, fill it up with water again. I had lovely hands, and I had very, very soft hojas to do my tamales. So that was the hojas. Then I got smart about doing all the masa, right? I mean, I wasn't going to do this. That's how you do it. You have to be air into the masa. That's what, how you get fluffy tamales. And I did not want to look like Marilyn Monroe, you know, doing all of this all the time. So I got out my big, big Mixmaster or the KitchenAid. That big KitchenAid, the same one I've had it for 50-something years. And I beat up all the masa. Now remember I said it's all about process. So you want it to look good. So as soon as everybody would come, I would put all of that masa in a big pot. And when people would walk in, when God would walk in, I'd be like this. But I had already done it all. And then when it's time to do all the spices, you do it with a molcajete. A molcajete is a mortar or pestle. And she didn't tell you about it. That comes from the Aztec times. So you have to grind up all the cominos, the chiles, and all of the garlic. But to make that many tamales, you can imagine how many spices I needed. So what do y'all think I got? What do you think I used?
Concrete charcoal.
That's an idea. Your coffee grinder.
Oh.
Yeah, so you grind up all the spices using that and then just push a button. As soon as the company comes, you get out the molcajete and you put all the spices in there and then you grind. So remember, it's about process and looks, and it's really getting together with all your familia, your friends and everybody to make it the one. So yes, I tell people how to make them. Show them how, and I still do it. I just did it at the Winnie Museum, and I just did it down at the Mercado. And I just did it on Sunday. Some days would go by so fast. So I teach people how to do it on the right side of the hoja, and how much you put in there, and how to fold it. But it doesn't matter. Sometimes the tamales are that big, and you cook it right next to one, because it's muy exquisito. So those are the gran tamaladas that I used to do. Then I decided I'm not doing it at home anymore. And I went to the Guadalupe 10 years ago. I went to the Guadalupe and I said, can I do the tamaladas for the community? So I did it for 10 years, teaching 300 people how to do the tamales. It was so much fun. And it had a lot of graduates in there. And then I turned it over to Cariño Cortez, who has been great donors to the Latino Resource Center, and they're doing it grand. So we did it, I guess it was Sunday, right?
Yeah,
it was Sunday. And there was like 700 people, and it was incredible. So for me to see this thing that I started 10 years ago blossom into this huge thing was really incredible. Along the way, they said, mi comadre aquí, I think you should write all this down, and put a book together. Admin. I do academic stuff. I don't do, you know, books about tamales. She said, no, that was down. Anyway, in a short time, I put out the
book. 3 weeks? I think it was something.
No, a little more than 3 weeks.
It was 3 weeks before we turned it over to the publisher. Wow. You can imagine that.
My last book took me 10 years.
Yeah. But we were working overtime, and we had all the tamales pitching at this. See, one of the things about tamales is that build a building or invent a way to grow a certain kind of crop. No, it was collaboration. Our communities never survived unless they were collaborating. And the essence of comadrasco, of being comadres, home mothers, as I like to call it, is that we help each other out. And so we called in our friend Velma, who's brilliant. As she starts to say, she did this, well, actually we have another collaboration here on the cover, because not only beautiful color.
My other friend, Rolando Briseño,
had done this piece of artwork in tamal shucks. He actually rolled the tamal shucks in paint to create this painting, which is in a book called The Smallest Table, which is here in our collection. He traveled all through the interior of Mexico, exploring tamales and turning it into artwork. And it's so I loved this piece.
Yeah.
And the piece is very nice when you see it by itself. But once Thelma got a hold of it, she started thinking about all the old, cheap tablecloths that her mother and her aunts and the little Mexican restaurants would use in their little tiny kitchens, little tiny tables. And so she made the theme of the whole book the tablecloths. So if you look in the book, the background remember that one? We had that one in our house. Or I remember that one that was at my cousin's house. Or the next door neighbor had this one. And so all of these,
the
that kind of design.
We thought the history was going to be pretty important.
It framed the tamales in exactly the place it should be, on the family kitchen table. And if you recall, these were not expensive tablecloths. They weren't made out of linen. They weren't woven. But she had such a way of pulling it together, and we were still collecting data for this, because this is a different kind of data. This is a different kind of research. It's not academic data, but it's community data. So Ellen's in the middle of the night, and Sandra's in bed saying, answer my text, damn it! You know? And I'm thinking, Ellen, she needs to answer this, what are her favorite tamales? You know? One of the things that's so important about tamales is that we need to recognize that it's a collaboration. You don't make tamales, you don't make very many tamales by yourself. You try to at all.
That's why we only make them once a year.
Yeah, you really have to have a lot of people pitching in. A nice phrase that we like to use a lot is getting your hands in the masa. You've got to get in, and you've got to dig in, you've got to get dirty, and you have to.
And the other thing that we thought was so important for my work and my identity is who are we? You know, what are our roots? What is our history? And what we found was the tamales are, somos the tamales, somos the maíz. So learning about the history, and then we asked Antonia Castañeda, who is a very, very noted historian, to write a short piece for us on the history of tamales, and it's the history of 7,000 years before Christ.
So yeah, this is not something that was invented 30 years ago.
So you're going to tell me a little bit about the history?
Antonia's article called Art, Labor, and the Genius of Women, A Short History of Tamales, she talks about the significance of corn in what are called corn-based cultures, the corn-based cultures of the Americas. And historically, traveling bands of human beings didn't have a chance to do very elaborate food. You killed a deer, you ate the deer. You settled someplace for long enough to gather berries or pick pecans, you ate the berries, or you ate the pecans. But making food that combined things was really an invention. Furthermore, the corn, as it comes straight from the plant, is not a thing. that's easily digestible in large quantities. So there's a process called nixtamalization, which is a delightful word, coming from the word nixtamal. The masa of the tamales, the nixtamal, is prepared in a certain way with ingredients that help make it more easily processed. It becomes more nutritious, it becomes easier to digest, and it becomes this continent's first fast food. Not fast to make it, but once it's made, you pick it up and you go out and you take it, and you don't have to have corn in one hand and meat in the other. You've got everything all wrapped up in it.
The other important thing about that is the gods, the corn god. So there's a corn god and a corn goddess, and both of them made us, according to mythology, in a corn god. Then a masa created us as humans. And one of the daughters had five. One of the goddesses had five daughters, and each one reflected a color: white corn, yellow corn, blue horn, red horn, and the one that's multicolored. So you can still see those different colored corns in the grocery store. And so from that, they created a new raza, an indigenous group. So we are children of the
corn. We're children of corn.
Yes.
And if you look back at the very earliest mythologies, the very earliest beliefs of the Mayan people about the origins, where dirt is what we're made of. This animal, he tries mud, and the mud just drips off like mud does.
Yep.
I need something stronger, I need something firmer. So the heart of the sky grows and makes human beings out of wood. And wood is firm, and it's strong, but it doesn't smile, and it doesn't move, and it doesn't have any emotion. So he sits down, and the other gods come and sit beside him. And they decide that after all this work, they're just so hungry. So they better do something to satisfy this hunger, you know. There's some corn out there. Let's get some corn. Let's cook it. It looks so golden brown. It's so perfect. It looks so delicious. It's firm, but it's soft. And all of a sudden, you go, we know what we're going to make our human beings out of. We're going to make our human beings out of corn. And that's why human beings are really stiff and unmoving and unmoved, nor do they just slide off the floor. Human beings are all beautiful, firm, flexible, loving, interactive.
So our tamales go back 7,000 years or more. In the Americas. So it's the most incredible food. Every time I make tamales, I think I'm using the same recipe that my indigenous ancestors were doing. Masa, the spices, with either venison or pork or sweetness with pasas and seeds and beans, all kinds. It's just such an organic food. Who we are. So that's why we love tamales, and we know that tamales reflect who we are, and that the instruments we use, such as the mocajete. Tell them a little bit about the mocajete.
What a mocajete. How many of you don't know what a mocajete is? Let me ask that first. Because it's made out of volcanic rock, and I know you can go to HB.
It's a mortar and pestle. It's a mortar and pestle object made out of.
It's a three. The grinder. And the grinder is so efficient that most of us that use it, I mean, a friend gave me a wonderful little garlic press for Christmas, a little little one that you stick the garlic in, and I thought, oh, that's so nice, it's so convenient. And I put it aside, and I grabbed my little one, and then did my garlic, because it does it very well. But more so, when I use my molcajete, kind of like when I taste the tamale, and I pull the leaves off, I am remembering my mother's kitchen, my grandmother's kitchen, and my great-great-great-great-great-great-grandmother's heritage. And that kind of a connection, that kind of a presence for anybody that lives on a continent where that has been the main sustenance, it's very important to remember that this was our modern invention, our useful invention, that today is still probably the most effective way to grind spices.
They were inside the cave walls. Oh, it was the best. the best art exhibit you ever saw.
I said,
cave art.
Huh,
we
I
have
never
everything
saw that.
In our civilization. I
and
know.
So that
we
was a,
and we have fire.
And then okay. so the drawings were about cooking?
No, but they were about buffaloes. Let's see, los tamales were in them too. And what did that guy draw? He drew at least four different colors on the walls. One was red, one was blue, one I don't know the name for it. But it was good art. We had sticks, we had fires, we had a good time all last week. What more could we possibly have in our civilization? Remember?
Well, but you know what? I hate cooking by myself. You know, I invited my mother to come over, so she didn't know how to cook anything. So I told her about doing the masa. You know, sabía cómo hacer la masa.
She must be uncivilized. What kind of cake woman is that?
So then, what did you do first?
Well, you know, we were kind of tired of just eating one thing at a time. I mean, she wanted to eat masa, and I wanted to eat venado, good tasty deer. I was like, well, which one's it gonna be? Because we can't eat both of them, because if we have masa in one hand and deer in the other, who's gonna grab the chimpayatas to keep them from getting too close to the fire, you know? So, Comadre here, she said, I have an idea. And she grabs one of the hojas that had fallen off an ear of corn. And she grabs her masa, and I say, what are you doing? And when we get food inside of an hoja, the hoja isn't going to taste good. Comadre, what the hoja are you doing?
Well, ¿por qué no le pongo algo en medio? Because that man of mine is bugging me all the time. That he quiere carne, he quiere frijoles.
Oh,
he wants me to make five dishes. No.
That's
good.
Isn't it gonna fall?
No. They put in the masa, and then on this one I'm gonna put beans, and I'm gonna make a double tamale. And on this one I'm gonna put beans, and on this one I'm gonna put la carne, and then I'm gonna fold it like this, and I'm gonna have a 2-for-1, and I'm gonna call it tamale, because tam means what? Tel means corn, mal means the dough. Yakista. And then I'm just going to put it on the fire and I'm going to cook it. And then it's that one.
Okay.
You like it?
That one. But you know what I'm going to put on mine?
Oh, yes. That was
cooked. Rabbit. I'm putting rabbit. I have rabbit today. Mira. I'm going to try this one. And how do we, if I put it this way, it's going to fall out.
Right. Oh, wait a minute. Maybe we should hold it at the bottom. I'll wait a minute. I'll hold it like that.
See. Hold up.
Mira.
Okay. Okay. I got it. Stick it in. Okay. Let's put some more in. Make some more. Ay, those guys eat so much.
In one pot. And then I'm going to put some of those seeds. Some of those seeds in there and some of those berries.
Chili.
Okay.
Chili. Oh, those are good seeds. I like them so much. We're going to spice this so good. It's going to be so delicious.
Well, that is the invention of a tamale.
And a couple of days later, when the guys got the hang of it, and they were getting can I take some of those, what you call them, tamales, with me when we go hunting next time? And I said, oh, pendejo, why do you think we made them? And so he picks up a whole bunch of them, he sticks them in his pouch, and he heads off with them and he says, hey, we're going to have a good expedition. I said, hey, don't eat too much, you'll be too fat to kill a deer. But he didn't listen. So we had to wait a couple of months before we killed another deer. Modern perspective on the traditional tamales. And she's from Humboldt, California. So her poem is called Recipe, Hinterland, Comadres. Here in Humboldt, we have one Mexican market, El Pueblo. And as the proprietor Maria says, at Christmas, todo el mundo comes to get masa for tamales. But I'm invited. I don't want to drive to the other side of Eureka to get masa trucked all the way from San Jose before daylight. I make my own masa, almost the same way the old ladies before me have done. You can do this too. Go to the market, the most agachado chain grocery. Even in the hinterlands of Aslan, we'll have masa bina in bags. Don't be a baby. Follow the directions on the back of the bag. Behind the face of ese viejo canoso, that old white-haired man who has no clue as to the contents of that bag. There's no excuse, honey. They even print the directions in the English. The trick, though, is in the machinery. Don't whine about authenticity. If your grandma had had a food processor, you know she would have used it. Deep down, the food processor is the twin sister of the metate and the moncayote. No seas mensa, pues. Wherever the diaspora has flung you and yours, dust off your food processor and make tamales with masa fresquecita. Once you have masa, your possibilities are endless. Traditional tamales de puerco, de pollo en chile verde, de dulce con raisins, or even, if you're daring, vegetarian tamales with only God knows what. So a little piece of our tamale experience. One of the things we feel proudest about is that we were able to reach out across San Antonio, really across the nation, and get commentaries from different individuals about their favorite tamales. Because once they started talking about their favorite tamales, a few of them did say, ah, de puerco, or de lote dulce, or oh, pollo con rajas de chile. But most of them start to reminisce, and you wouldn't just get their favorite tamales, you'd get your favorite memory of tamales. So we're going to share a few of these, because we got everybody from Vicky Carr and Edward James Olmos. We got then Mayor Julian Castro, we got Father Eddie Fernand.
Eloise.
Maria Eloise from the columnist, the hands from Eloise columnist. And even our Honorable Maria Antonieta Bedrizado, former city council person, first Chicana in the nation to run for mayor of a major city in the U.S., she said the best ones are always made by wives and female men.
Yeah.
And Ellen, you finally did get Sandra.
I got some. This is Nettos. Yeah. Santa Cisneros, as you well know, is a very famous author whose work has been translated into 47 languages at least. But anyway, I love hers. She's a very concise poet. Fat tamales are my favorite. I mean, the ones made in central Mexico and shaped like Mexican feet. Not the little sardine-shaped ones folks eat in northern Mexico and Texas. So she liked big square tamales. Like big feet.
Right. And we have other commentaries from people who talked all about the beautiful little sardine-shaped ones from northern Mexico, like Macatu. But some of you may remember the late great Willie Champion, El Burro. Fantastic flamenco guitarist, performed throughout the world. And he had one of the most magical statements that we got. He said, my favorite tamale is the venado, deer meat. My father would hunt the deer, and my mother would turn it into tamales. Las tamaladas were always a mystery to me, almost a gathering of brujas, witches. I remember that boys and men were asked to leave the house, and only the women would gather in one selected home. Boys would play at other neighbors' homes, and the men sat and talked and had their cervecitas. But when we got home, the tamales would emanate an aroma that I could still smell after so many years. Now, I realize those women alone have left their problems and their dreams and their hopes inside those tamales. Esos son mis recuerdos de los tamales de mi casa.
Hey, you know Sylvia Romo? She's the one that used to collect all your money because she
the high
assessor, right? She said, my abuelita made the best tamales ever. She was small, strong, and independent. She was also a perfectionist. When she died, my sister and I attempted to duplicate her tamales, but we were going high tech. We purchased a mechanical tamale maker that had two cylinders, one for the masa and one for the meat. The entire family was relying on us to have an abuelita-like tamales for our Christmas gathering. The meat and masa were prepared according to abuelita's specifications, and the aroma of the tamale meat filled the kitchen. We were so proud of ourselves and hoped that abuelita would also be proud of us. We stuffed the meat and the masa into the cylinders and cranked away. To our horrible surprise, instead of getting nice and neat tamales, the meat spurted up toward the ceiling and ended up on the walls, ceiling, floor, and everywhere else you can imagine. Imagine. The kitchen looked like a disaster area covered with red splotchy substance. The following year, we decided to go the old-fashioned way. Sometimes tradition just can't be replaced.
Okay, let's look at tamales from a little kid's perspective. How many of you know David Santana, who used to be with the Crayolas?
Still is.
The Crayolas. They call themselves those Tex-Mex Beatles. Very, very talented band here in town. And he talked about one of his tamale experiences when he was 9 or 10. He says, I guess I never seen how tamales were made, but I walked into the kitchen and there was my tiasais and my grandma Weiss up to their wrists in grasa. They were smiling. Their hands were glistening with grease. And there was a head. It looked gruesome enough to traumatize me. I still eat them, but that image will be etched in my memory forever.
You all remember Joe Bernal, our Senator Joe Bernal, who's now 91, can you imagine?
Oh, wow.
And he was the first Mexican-American senator in Texas, and just done a lot in bringing GSA to San Antonio. Definitely, when I asked him, what is your favorite tamale, Joe? Definitely the matcha tamale. When in the tamale assembly line, you run out of meat, then you add frijoles. And then when you run out of frijoles, beans, you add pasas or raisins. Then you have tamales and pasas until you run out of raisins. Then you add sugar to the masa and you make them sweet tamales. Then you run out of all of the ingredients except for the masa. And you end up wrapping up the masa all by itself. So the tamale made of just masa is called a macho. Yeah, right.
Terry Ibanez, artist, teacher, has illustrated numerous books. She's just an amazing human being here in town. She says, since I come from a family of tamale makers, I have several good memories. But the funniest one is when I tried making tamales on my own. My mother gave me the recipe for preparing the dough and the carne, and the meat came out perfectly. And the masa, I thought, was very good. I steamed my tamales, and they smelled delicious. But when I tried one, it was as hard as a rock. I hadn't followed the part of my mother's recipe that said, add a whole box of manteca, because I thought it would be healthier with less. I had to throw my tamales into a Rio de San Antonio behind my apartment. I bet even a fish couldn't eat.
And really, if you use real lard, and I'm not talking the one in the box, real lard from one of Michoacana or that is the best and healthiest.
Yes.
Manteca that
way
you can buy.
Crystal.
Yeah. Oh no, not very crystal. Anyway, there used to be a coffee house called Timo's Coffee House. And he says, when I was 17, a Panamanian friend of mine invited me to her house for tamales. I thought I knew what we were going to eat. But when the plates were served, there was only one tamale on mine, and it was huge. You had to cut through the thick banana leaves to find a tamale made of shrimp, rice, plantain, chicken, black olives, veggies, and who knows what else. But it tasted fabulous. Fantastic, yeah.
You know, Franco Mondini,
the artist.
World-renowned artist,
back and forth between Florence, Italy, and San Antonio. He said, one of the nicest compliments I ever got in New York City, asked by a fancy potential art client where I liked to eat Mexican food in New York City, I hesitated, knowing how many New Yorkers resented the Pueblacization of New York City, where all these people from Puebla were moving in to New York. In fact, those of you who don't know, the Puebla immigration to New York has become so significant that a lot of residents in New York now call it Puebla York. But we call it Pueblacization. Then I had to fess up, half expecting her to roll her eyes in dismay. I said, I love to buy the tamales from the street vendor ladies from Puebla. She then gently responded that she felt, with its growing Mexican population, New York would become a kinder and more productive city.
Oh, nice. And then I have a good friend, Rebecca Amazon, who's actually Vicky Carr's sister-in-law. Because you, by the way, when you make tamales, you have to have cheese in it. You got to gossip. So, did you know that Rebecca was, her brother is married to Vicky Carr.
El doctor de León is
Rebecca's brother. And she's a biochemist and a visual, fabulous visual artist. But you know, she's got a lot of tamales now. So, what would see that she's not doing too well. But anyway, she said, the rules for my mama, you cannot embalar las hojas until you master washing and draining. So that says you gotta learn how to wash them and the job of the pits would do. I'll be the one to decide when and if you're worthy to graduate to embalar. Embalar means to put the masa on the hoja. I will fill them, our mother taught, I will fill them, roll them, and only I will stack them in the bote. My eldest sister, Esperanza, was her taster, as well as my brother, Pedro. Shortly before she died in 1983, Esperanza and I took over as tamaleras. Mama tasted all of the fillings, carne, chicken, beans and cheese and jalapenos. Aren't you getting hungry? When the first tamales were done, we would give her the tamales to taste, as she said, with tears in her eyes. Ya no me necesitan. Ustedes ya son las tamaleras. So she was so sad that they didn't need her anymore because they had done a good job. She died before the next tamalada, and Esperanza took over. I continued to come to San Antonio during Christmas to help her. We laugh a lot now when we think of Mama as we tackle 60 pounds of masa for Christmas Eve. I cannot schedule going back to Maryland to be with our daughters for the holidays until my sister gives me the new tamalada non-stop, 3-day marathon of 12-hour days. Some time ago, I bought restaurant aprons. I hand-painted them with flowers and hand-lettered Hija de Tamalera. For my two sisters and myself, Jen, her husband, firmly coined the phrase, no healthy, no eating tamales. I am now the official taster.
And on this embalar issue, we want to close with a little very short story from a little quote from a woman that used to be the executive director of the World of the Cultural Arts Center, Patty Ortiz. Because we live in a modern world, we're not everybody understands Spanish anymore, and some words are kind of hard to translate. So this word embalar has a very interesting mistranslation. She says, on one of my family's annual holiday tamaladas, as my sisters and I were first learning this tradition, we asked my dad what he was doing as he was embarrando the masa on the corn husks. He answered with humor and twisted words, I'm embarrassing the tamales. To this day, every holiday, we make the tamales feel as self-conscious and uneasy as we can. I personally like the tamales that are lightly embarrassed more than the heavily embarrassed.
So that's our book. And Gavin and I still do tamaladas, but now we're the tasters.
We're the tasters. We're the supervisors.
We're the supervisors. So, and we just tell them to put on their lipstick and their eyelids and to be ready. But I'm going to be making my tamales. In fact, when I go home tonight, I just got in from Dallas, go home tonight, my The meat's cooked, so I'm going to go chop it up, put it in the refrigerator, and cook it tomorrow on a new videotaping and so forth to get ready for my tamalada. That will be very small, because I don't do big ones anymore. Just enough to make tamales for my family when they all fly in. So I hope you enjoy making tamales. And you know what? If you don't want to make them, you know what's a good idea? There's some great tamale places in San Antonio. Go buy a bunch of them. But before you invite anybody over, take them out of the photo, get one of your good pots, stick them in there, and let the water boil a little bit. You know what? Get a pot, put the water in it, put some cominos in it, and some garlic, and let it boil so the smell goes to the whole house. Then put the tamales in there, and then get a little sweat on your face, and be ready to serve them and pack. You're like,
we just fast forwarded to the end of the tamales.
Any questions or comments?
Comments or stories to share.
Yeah.
Was hoping to go to the tamalada over here, but I missed it because, first of all, I'm not paying attention. This time of year comes, I'm not paying attention. And things happen. And I go, wow, too late to do that. Too late to do that. So, fortunately, I walk into the library and I'm looking for something else. And I see the little sign there by the door. And I go, well, I don't know what that's going to be, but I'm going to that. So I tell him, okay, I'm not going home, I'm going to this. And boy, was I surprised. What a fantastic thing you guys put together. Fantastic.
And we got our book in the back to sell. So if you need recipes,
great Christmas gifts. People love to give them to their tias and their cousins and their daughter-in-laws and whatever, It's not just a recipe book. There are recipes. But it's got the fun and the flavor and the jokes and the real anecdotes that have happened, like when Gerald Ford came to San Antonio.
And you were to say?
I went to something with my grandmother who lives here. I lived in Amarillo. And I went to something when I was maybe 8 or 9 years old. And they had tamales as part of whatever it was to raise money. And so, did you want tamales? Oh yeah, I'll have one of those. Because I don't know. And I ate it, and I was like, can I have another nickel to get another tamale? She had a whole bag of nickels.
There's
other stories.
There's a story here about politics, and there was a lady in San Antonio that used to. She would fix the elections. You would tell her what the election was and who you were up against and how high the post was, and she would tell you how many dozens of tamales you needed to win, and then everybody was invited over to come eat tamales for the candidate that ended up winning. And in fact, when Henry D. Gonzalez first ran for office. The Henry B. Gonzalez Convention Center was named after a real old person here in town, and for many, many years he was our representative. And he ran against a guy called Charlie Good. And Good would do what all politicians used to do in San Antonio. They would go around there, the Mexicans in the neighborhood, bring them over, give them beer and tamales, have them vote, then put them back on the bus, take them back and drop them in their neighborhood, forget about them until the next time they were up for election. And they would service the community at all. So Henry B's campaign came up with a great group of phrase. It was drink Good's beer and eat Good's tamales and go to the polls and vote for what's out.
And that was for real. Anybody got a story or a memory? How many of you have made tamales? All right. Good. What's your favorite? Let me know.
Well, I wanted to make, my mom always made the tamales and my abuelitas. And so my siblings never really participated. So about 3 years ago, I suggested that we should continue the tradition. My mother is 95 years old. She can continue. So about 3 years ago, we started one of the holidays. We have a tamalada. And we had a lot of fun. It's a lot of work for get the but we also experimented with different, made some with nopalitos.
Those are delicious.
And, I didn't know you could do that, but yes. We were having fun. We were drinking cerveza.
Yeah.
My sisters were drinking wine. And there were some nopalitos in the refrigerator. And some made by them. They were really good.
They're good. Yeah. The nopalitos are the cactus. Mm-hmm. And you just saute them with onion and tomato and put them in that middle. But can you imagine if you're thinking of taco? I mean, I love the nopalitos. I make sweet ones also. And every year I invent a new one. So last year I invented one with, and you make little ones, sweet ones are very small. So I did it with the masa, but you mix everything together. Pick lots of pecans, because that's from Texas. And then a tangerine marmalade with my tree. And then chocolate, which is also from the Americas. And then tequila. And then you mix it all up and make little ones. So what's your favorite? You have a favorite one?
Yeah.
I do have a question, if I may. The cooking process itself, because I've seen pots being used, roasters being used. So what's the ideal process to steam them?
If you're
going to
make, you know, how many pounds of masa did you make? If you're going to make 15 pounds of masa, invest in a tamale pot. From Michoacana or Culebra, they cost about $30. But they're really neat because it tells exactly how much water to put on there, and this guy will stand. 15 pounds of masa will fill up that big container, and they don't fall into the water. Now, when I read that part about the mother saying, I'm the one that puts them in the pot, one of the old wives' tale is, but it's true, I think, is that one person should put stack the tamales. And I'm sure your mother tells you that. It can't, not everybody should be putting tamales in there. It takes one person, as many tamales as I made, I cannot put them in the pot nicely. I just don't know how to stack them. So somebody that knows that is very meticulous to put them in there, let that person put all the tamales in the pot. And then you boil them for about an hour in that big pot. Steam them. Much nicer than a roaster oven. Yeah. And now we just reserve that pot for tomorrow.
And we've heard all kinds of interesting commentary from individuals who have said, oh no, one woman said she would always put a penny in the
pot. Oh yeah, that's what I do.
Because when the water would boil, you could hear the little penny going, it's a penny.
And then it doesn't.
And then we don't hear anything. It's like, uh-oh, we're out of water, you know?
Yeah.
Because Penny didn't have anything to bubble with. So that's a very handy.
Yeah, but if you use a pot, you never run out of water. The new pot, I invested.
Yeah, because it's really high. I got one of those. It's really high on the bottom. Whereas if you're doing it the old-fashioned way, my mother would say, take the mano from the molcajete. So if you're using the molcajete, you took the pestle from the mortar and pestle, and you put it in the center of the pot that you were cooking in, and then all the tamales went on.
But you, really
but you always also have to worry about raising it up.
So we put the folded part down.
The folded part goes down. So every time you make a tamale, this is the way.
Open part is up.
Yeah. Okay. This is the way I make them. I don't put masa, because I love masa. I don't put masa or hojas are rectangular. So I put it like in a rectangle right here, leave a space at the bottom, a space on the top, and a space on the sides. And then I get the hoja like this, and then you fold it over, and then you fold, you have the open part here, and you fold it back like this. And that's where you put them, that's when you put them down. And when you open it, it's magical because it's never stuck to the hoja. It just rolls out.
One of the neat things that you can think about, unless you're really working with an item a lot, who really studies the shuck of the corn? You know, you pull it out and throw it in the trash can, right? But if you feel the shuck of the corn, even a fresh one, but definitely the kind you're using for the bottom is the bright one, one side is smoother, the other side has more distinct ridges. The ridge part goes out, the smooth part goes in.
And now all hustles are nice. So that when you bind them, they just naturally curl. So put the curl part in your hand this way. And you can use a knife or a spoon to spread them.
And I'm a, I'm a corn addict. I love tamales that are made that have real corn flavor. Like for instance, the white, the what they call the green corn tamales in Arizona. Why they call it green corn, I don't know, because they make it from what they call the white corn, which is not normal corn. Not what you think of as white corn. But anyway, no, we have to wait till the white corn gets here. Well, okay. And when the white corn would come, they would mix real corn into the masa. So they had kernels in the masa. So they had that corn flavor. And they would put this, they had variations on it, but the white corn does not have meat. The green corn tamales do not carry meat. They have cheese, white cheese, and they have chile. The rajas de chile verde. But they're very mild. You know, they're not the very ruby ones. So this was typical. This was, if you go to Arizona and you ask for green corn tamales, you're probably going to get white cheese, a green chili slice in there, and sometimes they will wrap it in the green chili.
Which gives it a different flavor.
It's a fresh corn flavor.
Yeah.
And I have my absolute favorite tamales. I'm torn between this green corn tamale and between a family recipe that two tias used to make years and years ago. We called it, in the book, I think we called it chaos theory, tamales. It was when everything's going on and the women are taking care of the babies and the baby's sick and this one's doing this and the men are out in the fields and you're having to bring the milk in from the cows and you're, everything is chaos. One afternoon, two of my tias out in the rancho south of San Antonio said, we have no way we have time to make tamales. And so they took masa, they threw it in the frying pan with the manteca, they threw in the meat, they threw in the kernels,
they made
a big queso of masa and corn and corn kernels and meat, and they got green shucks because they didn't go to the store to buy dry hojas, they had to save it. They just picked the corn off the stalk. So they took the green shucks and they put this mixture, threw it in a fast, stuck them in a pot, steamed it, and I can still taste. Mm-hmm. It's the tamales that were made in 1960-something,
wow.
Which they had invented in 1940-something, but it was an afternoon when they said, remember how we used to
do
that?
That's what we did that time. What are your favorite tamales? Lettuce?
Pork.
And how about you that make them up?
I really like chicken. Yeah.
You like what?
Pork and chicken.
Yeah. Chicken is my favorite. And yours?
Pork also, but I also want to say that up until 2 years ago, I had never made tamales, so I fall under the uncivilized classification that you talked about. A couple of years ago, group of us got together. I think you all may know Lourdes Galvan. Well, we all got together at her house, and they were assuming that I know how to do all this stuff. So they said, okay, go ahead and just spray the stuff on there. And I'm spraying it, and that thing doesn't stay on, you know? So I struggled for a few minutes, and they finally said, you know, maybe you should try separating the shots.
Oh, no.
I can handle that, you know. So I'm over here, you know, doing it. All of a sudden, they needed a lot of, you know, shots. And everybody was, you know, really, trying to rush through this process. And so I said, well, you know what? There's just so many of us. I need something else. Well, they assigned me the job of putting them in the pot. I went from this to this over here. And I did pretty good. I did them exactly like you were saying, yeah. You know. And I was the only one putting them in the pot, nice and neat, all very well organized, you know. By the time the whole thing was over, those tamales were very good, you know. But here I am, a novice.
Candlelight. All of the job.
And all these other ladies have been making them for years, and they just assume that everybody knows how to do it. No.
Well, what I really like is every time I go to these places, people say, I learned making tamales from Aunt Guadalupe, and we've been making them every year. Mm-hmm. So that's really heartwarming to know, like, Damido, that you want to go back and honor your mother, that your mother would be thrilled that you're making them. Mm-hmm. And then the chicken getting together with the family. And it really is about the process. Cheese made, laughing, crying, you know, storytelling, and then you're making some food.
And this will be fun.
And with that tequila. Don't forget, when you do the pot, to always get a secador or a dishcloth. And you wet the dishcloth and you put it on top. Now my aunt always said it has to be your best dishcloth. The one that's really embroidered.
That really honors the
comments. Yeah. Really hand embroidered and so forth. And you wet it, you put it on top, and that keeps the steam in there. So make sure that you do that. At my house, we also crown a queen or a king. We have a crown that was made, and you're crowned in it. Do you want to see a picture?
A page full of crowns.
Made out of hojas that a friend's aunt made for me, and I've had it for about 30 years. And my daughter now is 54 years old, and when she was 10, she did not like to eat tamales. Oh, there's Peter Gertrude also.
Peter?
And
Greg Barrios. Wendy's.
And she made an angel out of the corn husk when she was 10, so it's 44 years ago. That still is on our tree, our Christmas tree. It's kind of falling apart, but it's a signature piece. So you can make anything out of all husks, right?
That's right.
How about y'all over there?
I like the ones with processing in them.
Yeah.
And I like pork too.
And the pork. You don't ever try pork and fossils. I bet that's good. If you put raisins in with a pork, because
that's not much.
How about you?
The chicken.
I love the chicken. How about you? Oh yeah, the pink ones.
Yes.
The little bowl.
Oh,
right? Those are
good.
Yeah, those are good. I've never liked beans, but now I'm starting to like bean tamales with the jalapeno and the queso blanco in them. That's really good.
I have another question. I've noticed some tamales are tight. Why is that?
Well, the sweet ones you tie on both ends. You make them small, so you tie them both.
But sometimes,
sometimes
you make a tamale that's just special and it's so pretty. And this is the comment I get back from a lot of people say, it was pretty and it was tied with a little bow tie just for me. And woman, Manuelita, who spoke the other day at Miguelita, Manuelita was an immigrant to San Antonio at the age of 18. She worked hard for her life. She's a mature woman. But she talked about growing up in Guanajuato. And her family was so poor that her mother, for Christmas and for the other little friends, would make tamales. And that was a Christmas gift. She would make one tamale for each child. No,
it would
be a regular tamale.
Ones, right?
But she would make that one tamale so special for each of her children. The strips of the corn shuck that come out and so the tall part and you have little skinny strip. She would take it, she would tie that bowl with so much care, with so much tenderness, and she would bring it and offer it to that child.
That's sweet.
And the child would open it as if it were opening a present. They would eat it, they always tasted better than all the others. And I thought of this as being the sacredness of food, the sanctity of when a mother or any person nurtures and sustains with food. It's a special gift. So in at least one instance, that little bow tie was something that was aimed at one person. A lot of times you go into a big pot and there's a bunch of tamales, but there's always one or two of them that have a little bow tie on it. Those are the ones I think taste the best.
But also there's a practical reason, because you want to identify. The pueblo ones usually look red, but the chicken ones look white, and the bean ones look white. So you want to tie a bow around.
Yeah.
the bean ones are the chicken
and
ones.
And there's a third.
To keep the identified, because you might put them all in the same pot. So you might tie them a different way.
There's a third reason.
Yes, ma'am. And
that is that we come from a culture of poverty. And so you're not just like, oh, I want those and I want those and I want those. You use everything. So at the end, when all the nice hojas are taken and there's just strips, you might have to use like three little strips to get what you've done before the full hoja. So you lay those three strips out, you fold them up, but you're a little bit in blue out. Maybe these strips aren't going all together.
So you
tie it together. So that also, that's a way of holding, but making sure that it doesn't fall apart.
But pick your way. You know, you get your house up. These are the bean ones, and I'm going to tie the bean ones on top, and I'm going to tie the chicken ones in the middle.
Or the ones that have love in them.
The pork. Ones that have and the pork ones you don't tie. Any other questions? Do you make tamales? Or at least I make tamales home.
And there's, forgot to tell them about the regional variations. You probably figured this out, but every part of Mexico, and in fact, certain parts of the rest of Latin America, have their own style of making tamales. So you're going to get banana leaves in tropical areas, and you're going to get them wrapped in other kinds of leaves in different areas, depending on what the local, whatever's available. But there's styles, and there's spices, and there's flavors that go through it. And if you go back historically, there is mention inside the early Spanish priests that arrived in the New World, and of a certain kind of tamale called the tamalón. He found a village where they served a tamalón. A tamalón, this one, and this one, and you put one, and the whole town comes and eats off of that one. You open it up, they put entire chickens in the middle, they just go for everything. And so these are regional variations. And it's not like there's a right way or a wrong way to make them. Some areas are going to be have those great big tamales, and then here in North Mexico and San Antonio, we kind of tend towards the little ones, so we can say, oh, I'll have four tamales. You get in big trouble. If you're in certain parts of Arizona or New Mexico and you say you want four tamales, you're going to get four things this big, and then I'm going to sit on one plate, you know.
So we have pot holders here.
Yes.
What are those for?
Oh, those are free.
We'll autograph them if you want. And we're also selling our books in the back. But let's autograph the pot holders. Yeah. Any other comments or questions? No more recipes?
I would just say thank you for doing this.
Yeah. You're welcome.
I got your book about when I saw you a couple of weeks ago.
Right.
And I started reading it, and it's so funny. Some of the ears are so funny, you know, and it's amazing how you're able to capture all of these details within a 3-week period. Incredible.
Well, you have to understand that Ellen had already written up the recipes for previous tamaladas.
Mm-hmm.
And she also had the, La Cocina con Ellen had already been written. And so we just put it together and filled in the
I mean, if you want a YouTube, they did a filming last year from the Texas Bean Council on tamales. So you'll see me at my house making tamales. Okay, let's go sign the...
Yeah.